My name is Christy, and we are talking, your menu says, your schedule says Delta Condensed Guide to E-commerce and WordPress. We're doing a beginner's overview of what it might look like to sell things online. If you want to follow along, these slides are available at caldera.forms.com/WCBOS2017. They're Google Slides, so if you struggle to access them, I apologize, but they will also be available after my talk for the rest of forever. My role in WordPress, I'm one half of Caldera Labs. We are most well known for Caldera Forms, which if you were sitting in on the plugin panel earlier, Lauren mentioned as a potential alternative during one of the questions. That was very nice of you. That's us. We also do some developer education around Caldera Learn. And you can find me on Twitter if you want to tweet at me during or after the talk. This particular talk is one that I really enjoy doing because my role with Caldera Labs is on the business development side, my business partner's lead developer. So 40% of what I do is promote our products online or in person. And I'm pretty familiar with this topic. I love it, I do it every day. And maybe the other 40% of what I do is talk to users every single day and learn about the different ways in which you are using our plugins alongside other really awesome plugins, alongside the entire really awesome WordPress ecosystem to execute your ideas. So on any given day, I talk to people that are setting up application forms for animal shelters. I talk to people that are using WordPress for their fire departments. I talk to people that are using WordPress to sell three different types of candles, and they all have different needs. But there is a lot of overlap in the kinds of things that you do if you are using this platform and the plugin and the plugins that are available to you to promote yourself online. So this is a talk I really love giving because that's what I do. And the joke that I made last time that I gave this talk, which isn't that funny, is I feel particularly qualified to give this talk because I literally use WordPress to sell products on WordPress that are used for selling products on WordPress. And it's fun, and it's good, and it's a great platform for it. And my background, My beginning in WordPress was as a user as well. Was after I finished business school, I started a business, and my first website ran WordPress. So I really hope that if you're coming in here with wanting to understand really like what is out there for being able to start a business online, that you'll get a lot of useful and most importantly actionable information out of this talk. So, how many people in here are here because this is you? I want to start an online business, or I've already started one, and it's the beginning stages. Would anybody like to share what kind of business? I saw you raise your hand here in front of me. No? Awesome. Design and continuing education programs for nurses. That's cool. Any others? Yes, Mark.
I sell WordPress services online. WordPress services sold to everybody online.
WordPress services sold to everybody online. Those are pretty good examples of different ways in which one might use WordPress to engage in e-commerce. One of the latest things that I'm doing, and I keep using this example when talking about this talk, is my best friend from high school has started homemaking candles. And she is looking for a way to sell those online, to expand those sales beyond whatever immediate physical proximity she has to people around her. And she's using a combination of WordPress and Shopify to get these things out there. So more and more we're seeing people that are engaging in these kinds of ventures, which is really exciting, and that's why it's really important to understand that foundational bit of knowledge about what is out there, what is everybody who is doing this successfully using to successfully promote their online business. But before we get started in that, I do want to point out that this entire process starts with researching your product. When I'm talking about your product, I'm talking about all the examples that were put forth, and then some additional ones. So the candles are a great example. But then also your expertise, WordPress services. Online courses, continuing education. Your ideas. I do believe that if you are a blogger, you are running a business, whether you are doing that for money or whether you are doing that for the purpose of spreading information set that you believe to be important, you are engaging in these same sort of strategies to drive traffic to your website and to make sure that your website converts whatever that means to you. My first business is a nonprofit organization, so I collected a lot of donations. The way that you drive donations is very similar to a business that maybe WordPress plugins. Maybe you use WordPress to sell WordPress products that are used to sell on WordPress. And then the other part of this talk is this idea that it seems to be a big mystery to very many people that I talk to how they promote their business. My daily life, I get this a lot from everybody from a WordCamp attendee to my hairdresser. My hairdresser learned about Caldera Labs and he says, but how do people find out about it, right? And that's a really big question. And the reason that he asks that is because whether you are selling WordPress plugins or you are a hairdresser whose website is selling potential leads, right? People who email the hairdresser to say, hey, I'd like to schedule an appointment or whatever. We're going to be engaging in a lot of these very similar and very common techniques, regardless of what's going on. So in short, the problem is this idea that you can put something online, but that doesn't necessarily mean that people will arrive. Thankfully, WordPress is a really wonderful community. WordPress is great with SEO. WordPress gives you a bit of a head start, but we still have to observe how else we can promote our online business. So your solution is understanding this toolkit of the common tools that other people who are doing this successfully are using. And it's a very discreet list. And the reason that on this slide I point out that these common tools are available to you and your competitors is because this is a great way to start covering your bases. And when we're starting an online business and everybody in the room that is doing this at any kind of medium level knows this, you're going to wear so many different hats. So the way that I structured a lot of these slides, and you'll be able to download them online, is I want you to take one action on underneath every action in this toolkit that will get you up and running in each of these general big concepts. And then after that, we're going to cover how we go from doing exactly what everybody else is doing and just managing to compete, which in business school is something we call an order qualifier, into finding your order winner and figuring out what about your online business and your e-commerce site using WordPress is going to stand out and be the thing that people talk about. So if you were here for the plugin panel, their entire panel was basically this slide. And it's this idea that let's start with the most common question when it comes to WordPress e-commerce, which is how do I set it up? Set up your WordPress site. There are a lot of plugins that are available out there for the different kinds of applications that you might want to do, whether it's WordPress services, continuing education, WordPress plugins. I'm a big fan of Easy Digital Downloads. That's six. And that's actually the product that we use on our website to manage our sales and our business, really fantastic. It's also very useful for non-WordPress product-related things. So if you are distributing any other kind of digital content, fantastic product. Whereas WooCommerce is the one that everybody's super familiar with, huge community, really great for products. I mentioned Shopify when I talked about my friend with the candle business, and that's a really great, useful tool. When it comes to those other things that I might categorize as e-commerce, for donations, I really love GiftWP. I use their product pretty extensively in my nonprofit work, and they're a fantastic donation tool that will allow you to collect donations, set up recurring donations, and other things. And finally, if you are driving leads on your website, which is e-commerce, your website will most likely need a contact form. There's a lot of great contact form tools out there. I won't just mention mine. Gravity Forms is a fantastic product, so is Ninja Forms. Of course, we have Caldera Forms. And these tools are used for this idea of collecting the information from potential customers. So things you can do tonight. If you're sitting in here and you're sitting in here because you're looking at starting an online business and you want this crash course to e-commerce, there are three options that you can take. The first one you can do is install WordPress. Set it up, just do it, just get going. It was about 40% of you in this room that raised your hands. That means that sometime in between the sessions and the after party, you can get yourself set up. There's tons of great hosting companies out there who would probably help you through the process of setting it up. You're already there, you're trying to determine what else. The next step might be determining what e-commerce plugin you want to use as a platform. There's lots of great people here. I'm happy to talk after who can give you recommendations. But when it comes to WordPress e-commerce and starting an online business, I really do believe that the most important thing you can do is just get started. If you end up doing something that you later want to change, that's okay. Change happens. If you've already determined what plugin you want to use and you already set up WordPress and you're here to collect more information, my suggestion to you would be that you implement and put up something online for sale. And again, you can do that between your session and your after party. The most important thing to do is to get started. So the next big piece in this broad general toolkit is SEO. We could talk about SEO for the entire day. Every single session in this conference for the next 2 days could be about the different aspects of SEO. So what I'm going to cover here is that SEO is important. The vast majority of businesses are going to have SEO as the main driver of traffic. So whether you're a blogger, you are selling products, or any of the other examples on that list, you want to make sure that when people are Googling their needs, your services are coming up. SEO stands for Search Engine Optimization, and the methods for it are very wide and varied, but the most important thing for you to understand is what it is, and its degree of importance to your business. There are some businesses for whom SEO is going to be everything. Mine is one of them. There are some other traits in which SEO may not be as important. For example, last week in a WordCamp DC, I gave a talk about an old project I worked on, which was for a nonprofit organization that trains women how to run for office. And SEO is important for them, but it's not nearly as important as paid search because of the degree of competition. And being able to understand how much of your limited resources you should be putting into this, how much benefit it brings you, is probably the most important thing. After that, you will be engaging in the small and sometimes tedious, but you determine how worthwhile or not, tasks that boost your search engine rankings. So a big way in which we engage in an SEO strategy is by creating quality content. When we say content, a lot of us in WordPress think blogs, but content can also be videos, it can be tutorials, it can be infographics. Multimedia is king. And being able to create that content and put it out in a way that is consistent and is relevant and is useful is important to your SEO strategy. If whatever you are doing is very reliant on people going to Google with a concern and finding you, then content is going to be the way in which you draw them in. The way that you win SEO on the most broad level is by being useful. So if you were going to take one action after the after party, maybe tomorrow morning, I would say that the first thing you want to do is figure out your keywords. And the best way that you can do that is you can look to yourself and look to your friends and say, what would you search for to find this? So if I am selling candles and I have determined that SEO is an important part of my strategy for getting people to find my business and buy from me, I think I might focus on coming up for searches such as unique craft gifts. Or I might focus on something like local artists in Richmond, Virginia. Asking your friends and asking yourself is a great place to start. From there, you can go into google.com, you might have heard of it, and you can type in and see what comes up. You will get a good idea about what your competitors are doing. You will get a good idea as to what else, what other kind of content you could be creating by scrolling to the bottom of the page and looking at those related searches. If you've already done that, you know exactly what people are searching for. Come up with some content ideas. So, like I said, a lot of times that can be blogs, but it can also be videos, it can be infographics, it can be anything else that might help you stand out. If you've already done that, I challenge you to publish some content tonight. One of my personal goals for this year is to write more content. And the biggest blocker for me is starting. It's just doing it, sitting down, and hitting publish on something. If you are looking at ways to promote your online business, and you have decided that SEO is an important strategy, and you have a content idea set up, I would challenge you to put a piece of content on the internet tonight. I mentioned a nonprofit organization that determined that paid search was a lot more important to them than search engine optimization. That's what we would call SEM, search engine marketing. And you might have heard of it because you might have heard of Google AdWords. And the idea behind this is when you do a Google search, you see those ads at the top, and you want to come up there by bidding on a certain set of keywords. Again, we could have a week-long conference on Google AdWords. The important thing for you to understand is how important is this particular aspect of the toolkit to the e-commerce project that you are taking on. For example, for mine, it's not that important. Because my user profile scrolls past the ads. But you might have a user profile that does not. And making that determination is the thing that is most key to you sitting in this room looking at an ultra-condensed and high-level overview of e-commerce on WordPress. If you are to go home tonight, I would recommend that your first level is that you create your Google Analytics account. You can do this in 5 minutes and then it will exist. If you do nothing else, you'll have access to Google Keyword Planner and a lot of other interesting tools for really starting to think about your online business like a real hardened marketer. Your level two would actually be a suggestion that you trial an ad manager. There's a lot of services out there that are attempting to solve the problem of AdWords is confusing and expensive. And many of them will let you try them for free. Highly recommend it. It's an interesting way, if nothing else, to one, determine whether this strategy is important to your business or not. And two, to collect useful information on what kinds of topics are bringing people into your website. You've already done that, you set up the account, set up that small budget campaign, and just see what it does. You can Google AdWords trial, and all the different businesses that do this kind of thing will come up. That is definitely contextual to your budget, right? But you could run a $25 pay-per-click ad campaign and just see what happens. See what kinds of impressions you get, see what kinds of keywords get clicks. But again, the determination here is how important is the strategy to your business? It might be important for your specific business in doing continuing education, but the only way to find out is to test it. Email marketing, I love email marketing, I could talk about it all day. If you have an email account, chances are that you've been a subject of email marketing. There are three general broad types of email marketing campaigns. One of them is newsletters with lots of different articles, lots of different resources to get you to engage with the brand. You have your transactional emails, which are, hey, thanks for making this purchase. Maybe check out these other related products. Hey, your purchase just shipped. And then you have direct emails, which are, hey, there's 20% off any product until the end of the week. And these different categories all serve different purposes. Understanding the categories and making sure that you have a cohesive strategy among your email marketing is important. As far as setting up email marketing, same thing. Determine how important it is to your business. It's super important to my business because most of my users are professionals who are business. And so they're checking email, they're mostly on desktop. Super important. If I was selling candles, I don't think that I would spend my limited resources on email marketing. I think I might spend it more on social media marketing, which we'll cover. Making a determination is the important piece of this talk. If email marketing is super important to you, which may be the case if you are B2B, if you are selling to freelancers, if you are otherwise selling to people who are very much checking their email, they have strategies around checking their email, then I would say that your first step is to engage in email marketing app service. MailChimp is a very well-known one, so it's ConstantContact, AOL, ConvertKit. And make that form. Start collecting your email addresses. If you've already started doing that, I would encourage you to send a generic campaign. So send an email that maybe has a coupon, that's a direct email. Send a newsletter that aggregates some useful information, that's a newsletter. And again, see how it does. It will help you determine what people respond to, what works, and how important this particular piece of the toolkit can be to your business. There's a very clear pattern in the way that we do things when it comes to e-commerce and WordPress. If you've already done that and you've started to collect information, the real key to email marketing comes with sending personalized email. So if you've ever gotten a creepy email that says, hey, I noticed that you viewed this, maybe you want to view that, that's your next level of email marketing. You can set that up with most of the major email marketing services to start really communicating with people on a very personal level. My business is not on Instagram. That's because social media is very content dependent. We know what kinds of content works for social media marketing and what kinds of content doesn't work on which platforms. I really like this infographic. I imagine that, well, it doesn't seem like it's that hard to see in this particular instance, but the slides will be available online if it's something that you want to take a look at. It covers some of the major social networks and what to use them for. The general overview, the single sentence, one breath overview of social media is Facebook is for friends and family, Twitter is for business, Instagram is for lifestyle, Pinterest is for do-it-yourselfers, and Google is for local businesses. There's a very clear pattern here. What I want you to walk away with is what is relevant to my e-commerce strategy. I would highly not encourage you to try to be all over social media. I have talked to a lot of people for whom their first e-commerce strategy, the first thing they do when they set up a business, is they create a business Facebook, a business Twitter, a business Instagram, a business Pinterest, a business Snapchat, a business LinkedIn, and then they can't keep up. The key when it comes to social media marketing is relevant consistency. So being on there however many times a day, twice for Facebook, 12 for Twitter, whatever it might be, and making sure that you are putting out content that is relevant to your followers, that makes people recommend your followers, and most importantly, that gets people to click on those links that lead back to your e-commerce website. So you have an idea for a business and you want to take one action in between the sessions and the after party today, set up a profile page, but just set up one. If you are setting up a service, I imagine that one of the most useful things you can do is be on Twitter. Whereas if you are selling craft swans made out of extra work camp t-shirts that you've collected over the past 5 years, you might be better off doing DIY tutorials on Pinterest. And if you have a specific question about social media marketing, I'm happy to talk about it. I think that building community through social media is one of the most interesting and low-cost ways to promote a business. But if you're already there, I would suggest that you check out something like Hootsuite or Buffer to set up a scheduling system. Social media is ineffective if you're posting whenever you remember, and it's downright detrimental if I go on your social media page and I see that your last post is from 2014. So I would highly recommend using a scheduling system to continue to push out content on a pretty regular basis. And I would recommend focusing on one or two platforms for that reason. If you've done all of that and your social media strategy is on point, I would recommend boosting a post, which is something that you can do on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, and you put like 10 or 15 bucks behind a specific post. What's interesting about that is that it will give you more detailed analytics as to what's going on behind your posts, and it'll push out your posts to more people. Social media, especially Facebook, is a pay-to-play game, and getting that kind of data, again, will take you back to that square one, that main point of this talk, which is, let's figure out which pieces of this entire toolkit are most relevant to the kind of e-commerce that you're trying to do. So you set up your website, you set up your main channels that you've heard of, and now what else can you do? There's referrals. You should be telling anybody who will listen about your product and encouraging them to tell their friends. There's affiliates. You should be incentivizing those people to tell their friends. There's a really awesome plugin, Affiliate WP, we use on our website, that makes that a drag and drop process for you. Does that one count, Kyle? Yeah, great. It's one of their products too. But it's really a fantastic product, and we use it, and it encourages people to advocate for your product with minimal effort. When we're looking at WordPress and e-commerce, and most of you are one or two person businesses that are starting out, I want to give you big bang for your buck stuff. That's one of them. Things you can do tonight, make a list of people that can talk about you. If you have that, get the WP, it's awesome. And if you have that, something that I found really useful was to create a promotional toolkit. I have a little zip file, and it has a couple of useful tidbits, like how to talk about my product to your client, how to explain this product to a colleague, and a couple of brand assets, and a thank you note. And that goes a long way to making sure that other people are talking about my product, and that I'm taking advantage of these referral and affiliate strategies that help you go above and beyond putting stuff out into the world via email, social, blogs, content, and SEO. Yes? Yep. Yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you. We need to get you the microphone.
Someone has to put the slide up again, so while they're copying down, what would you recommend prioritizing in a promo toolkit?
That's a good question. I think the brand assets are probably the most important part. Depends on your business. If you're not a very visual business, maybe not. But I find that it's a useful thing to give to people to lower the barrier of effort. And that's what I'm trying to do with all of this. It's how can I get someone to take an action the least minimal amount of brain power. When it comes to referrals, when it comes to affiliates, the more that I can give them, the better. So the last piece of this idea of the magic sauce. So as I mentioned, all of this is established processes, order qualifiers. It means that either doing them because everybody else is doing them. When you're a small shop, I want you to definitely engage in the big bang for your buck stuff. You're not going to have time to have a perfectly crafted digital marketing strategy on day one, and you shouldn't. But the question that you should ask yourself as soon as you start collecting this information is, what am I good at? Which one of these is making the most impact on what I'm doing? That's how you go from doing what everybody else is doing and just being a part of the noise, which in 2017 is wide and abundant, and actually becoming a resource. For my particular business, it's content. We write a lot of tutorials, and we engage with a lot of WordPress developers who want to learn from our expertise. I work on a project that was similar to these, or that applied this concept to promote a coffee shop in New York where I live. And we sent out some emails, we got set up for a website, we did all this stuff, and we found that the most effective thing was Instagram, pictures of food. And so once we start seeing those patterns, we can allocate our resources intelligently. That's your secret sauce. And that is probably the most important piece to your WordPress e-commerce. Let's talk about plugins. Let's talk about the major categories of strategies in the digital marketer's toolkit. But most importantly, let's talk about what's the one thing that you're going to do to make sure that your business stands out in a crowded internet. That's my list. And let's open it up for questions. I think I have like 5 minutes left.
Did you find out that the Instagram was the most effective tool for your promotion for your coffee shop?
Instagram has an analytics feature that you activate by connecting it to a Facebook business page. So if you have a personal Facebook, you use that to set up a business page. And then on Instagram, you log in as your personal Facebook and link it to that business page. And then it'll provide you like impression analytics, just how many times people saw your pictures, how many times people clicked on your links, whatever. In that specific instance, a big part of that analysis was the people coming in saying, oh my gosh, we heard about this on Instagram, right? It was a coffee shop by the NYU area. So it's like, oh my God, we're on Instagram. I have to Instagram my food. Right? People were tagging her a lot more. People were using hashtags, were using the restaurant's name as a hashtag. So that was a big part of that analysis, but in terms of hard numbers, that's how you set it up. So if you've ever been on Instagram and you've seen a profile that will have the name, and then it'll have like an industry listed below it in gray, that's a business account.
Could you talk a little bit more about how you would analyze whether SEO or paid search would be useful to a given business? Would be more useful, which to?
So there's two answers to that, similar to this restaurant answer. One of them is the pure quantitative answer, which is on Google AdWords, you can set up conversion tracking to actually see which clicks are leading to sales. And when it comes to SEO, you can use a series of plugins to see what search terms are then becoming sales. The other piece of that is competitor research. And so I told you that I've made a determination for my business that, at least for now, search engine marketing is not as important as other places where we can put our marketing dollars, so to say. And I haven't made a determination because I set up conversion tracking. I made a determination because I know from talking to people that no one that I'm trying to sell to looks at the ads. They scroll right past. Like, even when I said it, I'm saying that it's a form of research to this room. A couple of you chuckled in agreement. I'm serious. And that kind of qualitative analysis is important for you to determine how to make those trade-offs.
Do you have any one particular often overlooked but easily accessible tool that you try to make sure everybody remembers?
I think if I had to pinpoint one thing that gets easily overlooked, it's personalizing those emails. Especially a lot of people in this room are engaging in businesses that are pretty dependent on email marketing, so you're collecting emails, you're sending newsletters, and I know this because that's our best-selling add-on for our product, is email marketing. That's the category that does the best. So we're talking a lot about list building, but we're not really talking about not being annoying on the list. And the kinds of lists that you see when it comes to segmented and personalized emails versus like blast emails are really significant. And I think that most of us don't actually see how significant that difference is until you start doing it. When it comes to our list, with general emails, we'll probably get an open rate of like 11, 12%, which is actually slightly above the industry average. But if I segment an email, I'm looking at 47% and up. So that's a big difference. And I think a lot of us sort of know that, but we're overlooking it in our marketing efforts.
Can you talk a little bit about security? I mean, anytime you have a form, you have a potential vulnerability, and it sounds like you have a two-person company, so you're using third parties to validate, you know, safe.
I will be honest and say that security is not one of the topics that I know a lot about. Like I said, I have a business partner, and that's how we divide the work. But with that said, there are a couple of big overarching concepts behind information security that I think apply. One is most security hacks are human engineering. Right? So people aren't trying to hack you as much as you're doing less than ideal things on the internet that are exposing your information from you being very honest. That's one. The other one is that security is an ongoing process. There is no product that will immunize you to security breaches. It's a constantly evolving process that requires monitoring. And the third and most easily implementable one is use reputable vendors. If we're worried about collecting credit card information online because it might be unsafe, your credible vendors will require an SSL certificate. Use Stripe. You know, use things that are established methods of protecting security. Don't take shortcuts. Like I said, a big part of my job is talking to a lot of our users and figuring out the best product solutions for the kind of project they're taking on, and they're wide and varied. And I have talked to a good number of people that ask me if it would be okay for them to collect credit card information and process it on site so that they don't have to use a payment processor. No, that's a bad idea.
This is the last one. You talked about affiliated marketing, and I was wondering if you could give some tips for those of us that are actually interested in doing affiliated marketing, so marketing ourselves to people selling products. Does that make sense? Or like the best, you know, ways to go about affiliate marketing.
I'm not completely sure if you mean that you want to connect businesses with potential affiliates, or yes?
Yes.
So that's an interesting question, because that's a lot of like the, how do I market my marketing business, right? That's what you're asking.
Right.
And the answer is exactly in these ways. You have your list of established tools that we're all using that you should know. You should pick the big bang for your buck stuff and go with it and find what your magic sauce for promotion is. I will say that I don't trust any SEO expert that doesn't come up on Google. And I probably wouldn't trust an affiliate marketer who doesn't have a good network of affiliates promoting them. I think we're done. Thank you. And if you have more questions or would like to talk, you can find me on Twitter. I will also be hanging out outside. I'm here all day tomorrow, so let's talk, be friends, be my friend.